Once again, sodium reabsorption is vital, okay? So this just gives you an idea of how much sodium that we're going to be reabsorbing throughout the nephron. So most of sodium gets reabsorbed in the proximal convoluted tubule, and it plays a really vital role in being able to reabsorb glucose and amino acids and urea and water and chloride. And then 25% of your sodium is reabsorbed in the ascending loop of Henle, which occurs with your chloride ions and your potassium ions, plays a vital role to produce urine of various concentrations. And then 8% of your sodium gets reabsorbed in both the distal convoluted tubules and the collecting ducts. And remember, that's under hormonal control. So that's going to be under control of aldosterone, as well as the renin-angiotensin system. Here we go, looking at reabsorption in the proximal convoluted tubule. So if you pay attention to the primary active transport on the basolateral membrane, if you think about the concentrations there, that should set you up to determine what the other types of transport are. We're going to begin then with number one here. And number one is your primary active transport. So this is your sodium-potassium pump. Here we're going to be transporting sodium from a low concentration inside the cell toward a high concentration out. And then potassium is going to go from a low concentration out to a high concentration inside the cell. So that'll give you your initial concentrations. So you have to have the sodium-potassium pump in order to maintain the gradients for sodium and potassium. Without these gradients, you won't be able to reabsorb sodium, and therefore you won't be able to reabsorb other solutes, including water. So now into the tubular fluid, into the lumen. So into the lumen then, we know sodium is at a high concentration in the lumen, moving toward that low concentration that we just indicated. So if we're using this little purple transport protein and it's not requiring direct energy, then we know that X must be moving from a low concentration toward a high concentration. So this is high X. So because one ion is moving along a gradient, the other solute is moving against a gradient, and it requires a carrier protein, and it requires indirect energy, we know that number two here on the apical membrane is going to be your secondary active transport, specifically sodium X co-transport or symport. Okay, so remember X can be glucose, amino acids, vitamins, and calcium, for example. Next, we have another way to transport sodium out of the lumen and to reabsorb it. So again, sodium is at a high concentration in the lumen, moving toward that lower concentration. And then we have hydrogen ions then that are moving from a low concentration in the lumen toward a high concentration in the renal tubule lumen. So number three here then must be a secondary type of active transport, specifically sodium hydrogen ion counter transport. And if you recall, hydrogens are not being reabsorbed here. Instead, hydrogen ions are being secreted. Okay, then the last type of transport occurring, well, second to last type of transport, I suppose, occurring here, is number four. And number four is just paracellular transport of your chloride ions. Remember that chloride ions are moving along an electrical gradient because they're attracted to the more positive atmosphere in the plasma due to the sodium reabsorption. Now, that takes care of all the membrane transport on the apical membrane. We've left out one more type of transport on the basolateral membrane. So remember that we used sodium to bring in X. So once we brought X into the cytoplasm of the cell, X is now at a high concentration and therefore can move out of the cell. And it's using a little purple guy, a little purple carrier protein. So number five here must be facilitated diffusion. And that's facilitated diffusion of X across the basolateral membrane.